Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in 2020. We have received apologies this morning from Alex Bull-Hamilton. I would ask all members and witnesses please to ensure that your mobile phones are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on the agenda is a Stage 1 evidence session on the University of St Andrews Degrees in Medicine and Dentistry Bill. It is for the Health and Sport Committee to consider the bill at Stage 1 and to report to Parliament accordingly. I welcome to the committee Professor Sally Mapstone, Principal and Vice-Chancellor of the University of St Andrews, Professor David Maguire, Principal and Vice-Chancellor of the University of Dundee, Callum George, Deputy Chair of the BMA Scottish Medical Students Committee, and Andrew McFarlane from the ScotGem Student Corps. Welcome to you all and thank you very much for joining us today. And we will now move directly to questions. And if I may start, I have seen the evidence or the views submitted by the different interested parties, and I noted Professor Mapstone's comment about the re-establishment of primary medical qualifications in an unfettered manner. And I thought it might be good to start simply by asking, what do you have in mind when you say an unfettered manner? What are the fetters you're trying to resist?
Well, good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for inviting me to the Committee on Health and Sport this morning. What this bill will do is to enable the University of St Andrews fully to support a fit-for-purpose National Health Service in the 21st century, by enabling us to graduate the kind of adaptable, compassionate and informed workforce that Scotland needs now more than ever. So to go directly to your question, the bill will remove an anachronistic prohibition unnecessarily in place for the past 50 years that prevents this university, even though it has a thriving medical school, from granting degrees in medicine. That prohibition came into force through the University of Scotland Act 1966, which reorganised Scotland's universities and enabled the establishment of the University of Dundee, now a great and thriving university. The prohibition on the University of St Andrews giving degrees in medicine was at the time clearly only intended to be temporary, but it has unfortunately remained in place. And it now significantly and uniquely prohibits the University of St Andrews, unlike any other university in Scotland or indeed in the United Kingdom, from offering degrees in medicine. So therefore, the legislation that is now being proposed would remove those fetters and enable this university, which itself has a thriving medical school, to be able fully to serve the NHS.
Thank you very much. Clearly, the immediate prompt for this is the ScotGem cohort and the intention that they should graduate graduate with qualifications from both universities, and that would be one of the outcomes of this bill. And the immediate impact of the bill is it then the long term intention of University of St Andrews to award full degrees in medicine dentistry independently of the University of Dundee.
Thank you, Convener. So, as you point out, the immediate trigger is the ScotGem degree. This is Scotland's only graduate entry medical degree, put together and proposed and now run jointly by the Universities of St Andrews and the Universities of Dundee. It recruited its first students who started in 2018. It's now in its third year. It is an unusual and remarkable degree, fully supported by the Scottish Government, in that it enables people who have come from previous professional walks of life, who have degrees in other subjects like pharmacology, to train over 4 years in a graduate entry medicine course, to enable them particularly to serve as generalist GPs in remote and rural areas of Scotland. So it is a flagship programme. We're proud of it. It's doing really well. That is our priority at the moment, and that is what the bill will obviously directly enable us to go forward with. Any further...
Indeed.
If I can just finish on your second part.
Yes, indeed.
That's okay, my apologies. Any further plans that we might have in the future to go for other degrees in medicine would, of course, themselves be contingent on agreement through the SFC and the General Medical Council. So the bill itself, although it would put us in the position of being able to put in place those proposals, would not itself immediately enable that as a possibility, and that is not our initial or immediate intention.
Understood. So the Scottish Funding Council, the General Medical Council, would have to approve any such step. Is there anything else, were you to reach the point where you wish to do that, is there anything else you require besides their support and the change in legislation?
Well, manifestly, places in medicine are controlled places. So if we were to be seeking that kind of fulfilment, it would need to be the case that we would have to have full support for an increase in numbers, for the running of a degree, and for the opportunity for placements to be available for those students. So there would need to be, obviously, a full consultation and work with relevant health boards.
Thank you very much. Can I now call Brian Whittle?
Thank you, Kabira, and good morning to the panel. I was going to ask questions around the impact on other medical schools, potential NHS recruitment. I think Aberdeen Health and Social Care Partners have expressed concerns here and noted that if St Andrews University were to increase their numbers or become a medical school in its own right, that would impact their ability to attract, train and retain medical students, given their rurality and location changes, challenges that exist. So can I ask, firstly, if you share the concern from Aberdeen Health and Social Care Partnership.
I call David Maguire.
Good morning, everybody. And again, thank you for inviting me to the meeting today. Yes, I do indeed share the concerns expressed by Aberdeen. Unfortunately, were St Andrews to gain a PMQ for undergraduate medical degrees, then I'm afraid it's not a zero-sum game. It's highly likely that that would have an impact on the other four medical schools which currently exist in Scotland at the present time. As far as Dundee's concerned, roughly 20 to 25% of our students have their placements in Fife at the present time, and were St Andrews to expand in that area, we would be concerned that that would impact on our ability to place our students in Scotland. We don't think that Scotland does need another medical school at undergraduate level. Scotland educates currently more places per 100,000 of the population than the rest of the UK. And indeed, as a consequence of the additional qualified students coming through following the recent exam season, the existing medical schools will expand by 100 places across Scotland. And many of those places were taken up by students from low participation areas and students who've got disadvantaged backgrounds, an area which Dundee excels. Since 1966, nothing's really changed, actually. The medical facilities, the teaching hospital are still in Dundee. The staff remain in Dundee. And we don't see that there's really a need to expand in this area. Although you will have observed, I'm sure, that we do support the case that St Andrews is made to gain short degree awarding powers for ScotGem solely.
Thank you very much. Brian Biddle.
Thank you, Kavir. If I could ask a little supplementary to that. We are aware, of course, that sort of medical professionals in Scotland, there is a shortage across the board. In fact, with GPs, there's actually a limited number of places for Scottish students, even those with qualifications. Would it not be to the advantage of the NHS generally in Scotland to be able to take on more medical students?
Yes, I think it would. Excuse me. Yes, I think it would be. And the existing medical schools are perfectly capable of expanding their capacity to take on more medical students, as has been shown in the current application round where we took over 100 students collectively. And the existing provision would be it's possible to scale that up in existing medical four medical schools.
Thank you very much. I see Sally Mapstone.
The opportunity to comment on this. Let me first of all remind you, of course, that the numbers for the ScotGem course are already in the system, so we're not talking about new numbers there. Let me also remind the committee that the programme for the Scottish Government's programme for government last year did put forward proposals for the establishment of a new medical school in Scotland. Those proposals are currently stayed, but may of course come back on the table. The University of St Andrews does have a proposal, a bid within that round. I think it's of course absolutely understandable that every university will say that if there are to be more numbers on the table, they will want them for themselves. The nature of our engagement with medicine across the piece, and you can see it in the ScotGem programme, is that we see ourselves as working collaboratively in a hub and spoke manner with health boards across the country, as is already evinced by the ScotGem programme. So our approach a collaborative and essentially very collegial one. Let me also again just remind you what this bill does. It essentially levels the playing field. It removes from the University of St Andrews, if it is enacted, a restriction which no other university in Scotland and no other university in the United Kingdom currently labours under. We would say that that is an unfair and unnecessarily prohibitive restriction. And in the event that our bid for a medical school were to be successful, if this bill were not to be enacted, we would be back here again. That seems to me not a very good use of parliamentary time.
Just for absolute clarity, Sally Mapstone, I think in response to my questions, you said that St Andrews had no plans for PMQ other than through the ScotGem process, but you've just said that you are preparing a bid for a new medical school. Which is it? Are they compatible or are they contradictory?
So I'm taking absolutely nothing for granted. If we were to be successful in our bid for a medical school, then various things might all from that. But given where the process is at the moment, our current intention is to focus on ScotGem and then see where we might go beyond that, depending on whether the bill is enacted and depending on whether our bid for the medical school were to be successful.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Just finally, Convener, Indeed, I've indicated a preference that they would like a partial removal of the prohibition. Can I ask if St Andrews would have any objections to that particular line of travel? And if so, why would that be?
I take it. Thank you. I take it that question is for me. Yes, we would, for the reason that I've just given. We think that levelling of the playing field and the establishment for us of an opportunity fully to participate in the provision of a fit-for-purpose National Health Service in the 21st century is better enabled through the passing of the bill as currently drafted than through doing so in a partial way which responds only to the immediate situation.
David Maguire.
The 1966 Act was amended, I believe, in 2002 to allow St Andrews the award of a postgraduate medical degree. And it would seem to me it would be possible to amend the current Act to support the awarding of degrees for ScotGem alone, which would be a position that the University of Dundee supports.
Thank you very much. I'm looking to see if either Callum George or Andrew McFarlane, our student representatives, have any views they would like to put into the discussion at this stage. If so, please put an R in the box. Callum George.
Hi there. Thank you for the invite. Good morning. So something that hasn't been included in the written submission from the BMA on this bill, but something I can bring today, is that it's the unanimous feeling of the elected representatives from the medical student bodies of all of Scotland's medical schools, including Dundee, and from the non-ScotGem body at St Andrews that that this bill goes ahead, very much for the same reasons that Professor Mapstone has mentioned. It just seems, I mean, it's of course for students, these concerns are a bit beyond us, a bit perhaps above our heads when we are focusing on our studies. But just to mention that that is the unanimous feeling of the elected student representatives at the DMA from the medical student bodies across Scotland.
Thank you very much. And Andrew McFarlane.
Good morning. Thanks for having me. I echo what Callum said. This is a bit beyond the students, and really I'm here to speak about, you know, my colleagues and my peers in the other year groups and in my year group, that really our focus is making sure that we graduate with a degree that's from both universities and that merits the sort of spirit of the course that we're on. Whether it's repealed partially or not isn't really something that we properly ask the students. We asked them a bit more informally, and we didn't have any concerns from the students, really. And on a more personal note, I think the only thing I can think of that would have an impact on the students in terms of their thoughts, if it was a partial repeal, as if it was a private medical school that was developed. But if it was just on a sense of fairness, as Professor Mapstone said, I think the students would be in support of it being fully repealed. And as she said, you know, this is a controlled, student places are controlled by the government, and it would really be on the merit of the proposal that the universities put forward that those are awarded, and not by sort of 50-year-old laws that are in place.
Thank you very much. I have supplementary questions, first from Sandra White and then from Emma Harper. Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Convener. The question was for the Professor. Professor, in answer to the Convener when mentioned about the proposed new medical school and regarding ScotGem, etc., you mentioned various things may fall from that. I wonder if you clarify, would that mean that the remit that you were given would actually expand into other areas? I just want to be a bit of clarification on that particular one, please.
Sorry, Mapstone.
Thank you very much. So what I meant from that is, let's face the fact that we're facing the greatest health crisis that any of us have ever known. We need to regroup and think about how we offer healthcare in the 21st century. And my firm view in relation to that is that the more creative, engaged, focused, and community-aware forms of medicine we can offer, the better. What we've shown through the ScotGem programme is that that is the kind of healthcare that we are capable of offering at the University of St Andrews, with a particular focus on those who may find it difficult to access healthcare, those in poverty, those in remote and rural areas. That is the basis of the ScotGem degree, and that is the basis of the kind of compassionate, adaptable and flexible healthcare that we believe is going to be necessary in the post-pandemic world and in the 21st century. In relation to our bid for the possible medical school, we would very much be looking, if we were to gain additional numbers, and let me repeat again that any bid that we might make for numbers on the basis of gaining a medical school would need to be approved by the SFC and the GMC. In that event, we would be looking to roll out more of that kind of healthcare, and possibly then in the fullness of time to set up other courses, degree courses, which would respond to that. But that is obviously all in the future. What I'm giving you a sense of is the kind of medicine that we would want to be offering, which we believe is incredibly important to healthcare in Scotland in the 21st century and in the post-pandemic era.
Oh, certainly, Sandra. Yes, please do come back.
Convener, I just wanted a small supplementary. The concerns that have been raised by the other universities, Professor, as you've heard and read the papers, if, as you mentioned earlier, we'd be looking to go further in regards to that, and it may be in the future, Would you not agree that these concerns are merited in that respect?
I just think these... Sorry, thank you, Convener. I'm afraid I simply think these concerns are exactly what you would expect some other medical schools to say. I understand that everybody is concerned about their numbers, but I'm asking us to look a bit more broadly to that and to actually ask ourselves what kind of healthcare do we think we're going to need in the next century? How more broadly based is it going to be? Is it not going to involve working with health boards across the country, which we can already demonstrate that we can do with ScotGem? So while I understand the concerns, I'm very myself concerned that this should not be seen as some kind of relatively new power grab. The University of St Andrews has had a medical school for the past 50 years. It's built a great reputation for research and teaching and for serving medicine in Scotland. It is simply seeking the opportunity in the future, if it should be availed of that, to be able to do so from an even playing field position, which is currently available to all other universities in Scotland and the UK, which wish to offer medical degree courses. Let me repeat again, we are the only university in the country which actually has a legal prohibition to stop us doing that. And I would ask members of the committee whether that in this day and age seems especially fair.
Thank you very much.
Emma Harper.
I'm sorry. Is that okay now? Okay, thank you.
It is.
It's a complimentary question to Professor Sally Mapstone as well around widening access. So for me, as a South Scotland regional MP, I'm keen to get more doctors recruited into Dumfries and Galloway, and ScotGem's been doing great for us in the South West. If we're talking about a new medical school, it wouldn't necessarily need to be a model where everybody has to go on site to St Andrews. Would a hub and spoke model be part of any consideration for a new medical school where campuses could be based off site but work together?
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed for that question, which is much appreciated. It may interest the committee to know that at the moment ScotGem has students in placements in about 72 different GP surgeries and bases spread across the country. And one of the things that we have also found through our programme is that because we have two dedicated virtual programmes, that enables us to platforms, that enables us to bring in the expertise of people based right across the country to help us participate in our teaching. The hub and spoke method that you mention is one that we would be very, very keen to roll out more broadly. As you may know, ScotGem already works not only in association with the University of Dundee, but also in association with the University of the Highlands and Islands. And let me also say that what we have found since we've been recruiting for the programme to go to the widening access point is that a greater number of both applicants and entrants from IMD 40 areas apply to and are successful in admission to the programme. At the moment, 35% of those who apply come from IMD 40 areas and 28% of entrants. That's about twice the normal rate in other subject areas. So we are showing that our programme is itself not only working for those in disadvantaged areas, but appealing to those who at the age of 18 were themselves residing in areas of multiple disadvantage.
Thank you very much. And I'll call David Trotters.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. In submissions to committee, it details the effect that prohibition has had on St Andrews University's research ratings. What practical difference will the ability to grant primary medical qualifications make to St Andrews research ratings?
Danny Marston.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for broadening out the question to approach research. The university is already seeing the value of all the resource that we ourselves have put into the medical school. In the complete university rating last year, it went up from 17 to 8. But not being able to award primary medical qualifications does, for example, impede us from applying to certain research funding, and also, for example, to be able to recruit spreads lecturers. Those are lecturers employed to undertake research, and you can only employ them at the university if you have a primary medical qualification. So there is absolutely no doubt to us that the capacity to be able to award primary medical degrees would increase and improve still further our research capacity and would broaden the base of those we can employ. And let me emphasise that we again see this very much from an evidence-based perspective. Our particular expertise in St Andrews is in evidence-based medicine and early diagnosis, and I think what we've seen over the past year is that early diagnosis is going to become an increasingly important aspect of medicine in Scotland in the future.
David Thomas.
My final question, Convener. Will it make a difference, given that St Andrews will still not be able to grant primary medical qualifications independently of Dundee?
I'll hear, I think, this time from first from Sally Mapston and then from David Maguire. Sally Mapston.
So I'm not sure that I'm entirely understanding your question. The ScotGem degree is a joint degree, which we are extremely proud of and which we are very, very keen to award jointly with the University of Dundee, as has been the nature of the proposal all the way through. Any further degree awarding powers which we might gain for other degrees which we might wish to award in the future would not themselves have to be in association with the University of Dundee. We would, in the event of wishing to put other courses together, be applying in a separate manner for those courses.
David Maguire.
Thank you. As I said earlier on in my response to an earlier question, the University of Dundee does support the lifting of the restrictions for the purpose of the ScotGem degree. But it's also clear from the arrangements that were that restriction not be lifted, then the fallback is that the degrees would be awarded by the University of Dundee under our current PMQ. If I could also just comment on the importance of widening access to medical students in Scotland. The University of Dundee leads the field by quite some margin here. A very large proportion of our students are Scots domiciled, about 80%, and a significant proportion of our students do come from IMD 20 postcodes. So we are the leader in this area, and if it's the wish of the Scottish Government to expand its medical provision in that area, then that's something that our university is particularly adept at doing.
Thank you very much. And I call Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. This question could be a question for Andrew McFarlane. If this bill is not passed, then the ScotGem students would be awarded their degree from Dundee University. But in the submission from Andrew, it outlines that a survey of the ScotGem students found that 97.5% were in favour of both university badges being on the degree certificate. So I guess my question is, what benefits do you think, and this probably is for Andrew, what benefit do you think the joint degree brings?
Thanks very much. I'll call Andrew McFarlane. If Callum George wants to come in, please just put an R in the chat box. Andrew McFarlane.
Yeah, thanks for the question. As I said, we surveyed when we were first approached. We surveyed the students about what they thought, and you know, getting students, let alone medical students, to agree unanimously on something is pretty difficult. And they were overwhelmingly in favour of this, and it reflects, as I said earlier, it reflects the spirit of the course. Developing medical students is not easy, and developing a new course is even harder. And this really is a joint approach. The first 2 years are managed by St Andrews, which I've already done. I'm in my third year now, based in a GP practice in Thurso, which is where I'm phoning you from today. And I'm here for 10 months. And this is managed by the Dundee University. And my next year will be managed by Dundee too. And really, you know, looking after students and medical students, especially in these times, is no easy task. And it's a considerable amount of resources that goes into that. And if it was only just the University of Dundee badge on our certificate. I don't think it would really match the course that we're on and match how we feel as students. I said in the submission that we're often asked if we see ourselves as St Andrews students or Dundee students, because we are members of both from day one. And we quite often say that we're ScotGem students, because this is a different way of teaching medical students and medical education as a whole. And that really, I think that the degree should reflect that. And if it didn't, it would be, I think it would be a bit of a failure in terms of what the students signed up for and how they feel as students. And I think it's important to remember that, as we said earlier, these are students who have done a degree before. I did pharmacy before I did this. But some of the students are much older, and have children and families, and were very high up in their field from where they came from, and sacrificed a lot to do this course. And they've also taken the optional bursary as well from the Scottish Government, that for each year they take it is a return of service for working in Scotland. So I think there's an awful lot of goodwill around this course, and it's been great so far. And I think that how this is handled is really important, and how the students feel themselves. So, definitely in favour of both universities being on the degree certificate, and the students fully expect that as well. Thank you very much.
Callum George.
Yeah, I'd just like to say, mirror Andy's comments. Similarly to him, I'm a third year ScotGem student myself, speaking to you from Campbelltown. And it's the view of BMA members who are also ScotGem students that there are many kind of attractive and interesting things about ScotGem which cause them to apply and which make the programme unique. But one of those things was the fact that the joint award was offered as something that was almost expected by people who wholesale who applied to the course. I think the number of people who may have applied to ScotGem because of the possibility of a joint award could be offset by a number of people who might have not applied to a medical program that was relatively unproven and still undergoing GMC validation, which was obviously expected to complete. But to reiterate what Andy said as well, that the students of ScotGem largely support this. It's something we found as well with our own members, that the vast majority want to see the joint award, because for the first 2 years, it's the University of St Andrews that do look after us. We spend a lot of time there. We spend a lot of time with the staff and in Fife and working alongside the students from the non-ScotGem cohort. And I think even after the subsequent two years, where the University of Dundee primarily manages the course, we'd feel it would be like something was missing from the final degree if it was to come solely from Dundee in the same way that the remainder of their undergraduate body received their degree.
Thank you very much. Emma Harper.
Do you think it might have an effect on future intakes then if a joint degree couldn't be awarded?
Andrew McFarlane.
I'm not sure is the honest answer. I think it would take a lot of momentum out of the course, and especially, like I said, how the current students feel is important. Students who are on the course will have peers in the professions that they came from before, and other students who approach them and ask, what's your course like? How's things going? And those are important metrics for students who are applying to medical school about what is it they're applying to. And if the goodwill of the students on the course is affected by decision to not graduate with both degrees, then that could have an effect on the advice they give to people applying if they feel like the course they signed up for isn't what they're undertaking.
Emma Harper.
Just a final question, convener. I mean, my experience of ScotGem in Dumfries and Galloway and my recent meeting with Dr. Fiona Graham was that it was excellent and the feedback was so good and the students are performing really, really well. So I'm wondering how many future intakes of ScotGem are expected Is it going to just be a course that will have an end date, for instance?
David McGuire.
The course will continue. There's an annual intake of around 55 students, and we're led to believe that it's an intention to continue to do that, and we would hope that will be the case.
Thank you very much. I now call David Stewart.
Good morning to our witnesses. I'd like to follow up some questions about ScotGem, and just to clear an interest, as a Highlands Islands MSP, I work very closely with the University of Highlands Islands, and I've been to see the ScotGem course at the Centre for Health Science, so hopefully I've met Callum and Andrew in the past. When I meet GPs, particularly in rural and very rural areas, they explain to me how difficult it is to both retain and to recruit GPs. And a Thurso practice told me that the best way to solve the recruitment problems is to ensure there's more Highlands and Islands young people going to study medicine. Do you agree with this? Is ScotGem the way forward for our workforce planning for the have?
I think we got the gist of that, although not the last couple of words. Perhaps ask both principals, David McGuire first and then Sally Mapster. David McGuire.
I do agree with the central point which was made, in that it's really important for Scotland to increase the number of medical practitioners, and that the best way to do that is to recruit Scots domiciled students. And indeed, the University of Dundee has around 80% of its regular annual intake from Scotland, and we pride ourselves in the fact that we train people to go into the local workforce. The numbers are slightly smaller in ScotGem, but indeed that's a goal of that programme, is to recruit and train medical professionals who will reside in Scotland and will support the Scottish population.
Thank you very much. Sally Mapston and then Andrew McFarlane. Sally Mapston.
Andrew McFarlane mentioned the fact that there is a bursary scheme that's associated with ScotGem, which is a bonding arrangement. So for every year that you take the bursary, you commit to working in Scotland. 94% of students who are on the scheme thus far have opted for the bonding arrangement, thereby guaranteeing that we will see more GPs working in remote and rural areas. And I think that's been one of the many success stories of the scheme as presented. The exposure that it gives students to working in GP practices both gives them that sense of the value and importance of working in those locations, and gives them a sense of the different kind of general practice that is often necessary in those kind of communities. So far so good, I would say. I think, you know, when you listen to the students, you hear what a big difference it makes to them. I do think that we need to work harder with the University of the Highlands and Islands, absolutely, to ensure that we get the throughput from their own undergraduate medical courses, to ensure that students who have graduated from UHI can themselves, should they wish, qualify to apply for the graduate entry medicine course, ScotGem.
Andrew McFarlane and then Callum George.
I agree. I think a big part of the ScotGem course is the rotation through different health boards. So I myself, you know, I'm from Paisley, you know, I'm from the town, you know, essentially, and I'd barely been to Inverness, never been to Dumfries, and I think I'd been to Thurso once, although I was too wee to remember. You know, but you know, I've spent, you know, months in Dumfries last year, in Inverness, and different practices there. Then I'm in Thurso here for 10 months, you know, and in first year I was in rural places of Fife. So, and the real thinking behind the course is that the more time you spend in places, the more comfortable you are with the idea of working there. And, you know, if you set down roots, you know, I'm here for 10 months in Thurso, and, you know, the whole idea is that people become more open to the idea of working rurally because they've spent time training there. And really, although I think it's important that we get students from the Highlands and Islands, I think that the important part of ScotGem is that it exposes students who maybe would never go there usually to that area. And then when you graduate and you've done your training, the idea of maybe working in the Highlands or working in Dumfries or somewhere rural, the actual step of, I've never been there before, has been eliminated because you have. And so I think that's an important factor to consider with how we train doctors in the future. And I think ScotGem is a new way of doing that. And there's definitely things that we can work on as we do go forward. But I think it's an important aspect of it in terms of the future.
Thank you. Callum George.
Yeah, speaking from my own experience, you know, I have an interest in remote and rural medicine, which attracted me to apply to the course. But it was never a guarantee. You know, it was never a 100% surety that that's what I wanted to do. And it's that exposure that Andy talks about, which has cemented that for me. And I know that for other members of the cohort, who again were, you know, it was on their list. It was on their list of possibilities and certainly an option for them, having been exposed to that environment as the normal day-to-day experience on ScotGem has cemented that for them as well.
David Stewart.
Thank you, convener. Has there been any survey of career intentions amongst the current student cohort?
Sally Marston.
We regularly engage with the cohort, and I think the answer that I gave to your previous question is very relevant here. The fact that students who are bonded with their bursaries have taken up that bursary opportunity gives a clear indication that 94% of them are fully committed to working in Scottish GP practices. So we survey the cohort both for their sense of the course and for their intentions, and responses are extremely positive, as you've heard from Andrew and Callum, both in terms of what they've experienced thus far and in terms of the way their eyes have been opened up to the future of general practice work.
Andrew McFarlane.
I just wanted to reiterate that the course is aimed at producing generalist practitioners, which I think is a bit of a PR thing that we're working on, but it's not just GPs, it's any doctor that sees a patient without any clinical diagnosis in front of them. So that could be a general practitioner, or it could be an A&E, or you know, a pre-hospital care doctor, or a general medical hospital doctor, or rural practitioners like we have up here. So that the return of service bursary is purely to work and train in Scotland after graduation. And so that can be in any domain, you know, surgical or medical or otherwise, and not just in general practice. But the part of the course is based in general practice, and the thinking behind that is the more you're exposed to it, the more chances you are that you fall in love with it and want to be a GP afterwards. But it's not exclusively to produce GPs, although it is a aim of the course.
David Stewart.
Thank you. My final question. The current ScotGem courses, as I understand it, places for 55 students per year. Has there been any discussions between Dundee and or St Andrews with GMC, Scottish Funding Council, or the Scottish Government about increasing the funded places?
David Maguire.
Yes, there have been some outline discussions about that, and I think both universities would very much welcome the additional places. But as you're probably aware, medical undergraduate student numbers are controlled currently, and so we haven't been able to increase the intake.
Emma Harper.
Maybe a really, really detailed question, but I am really interested in ScotGem, as I am still a nurse, and just hearing about how medical professionals are now expanding into primary medical qualifications is really interesting. One of the challenges for us, though, in Dumfries and Galloway is that there's a 50-mile limit on where you get to have your GP practice assigned from your primary site, so that stops trainees going to Stranraer because it's 75 miles away from the Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary. Is that something that is being looked at or could be looked at so that the rural challenges of recruiting into somewhere like Stranraer could be achieved, for instance?
David Maguire.
Jim, I'm afraid I can't answer the detail of that, but I can certainly say that it's something we'd be very happy to take a look at to see if it is possible to examine placements in practices in Stranraer.
Thank you very much. Callum George.
It would be interesting to see the detail on that, just because I'm based within the NHS Highland Health Board. The primary site or regional general hospital for that health board is Rigmore Hospital in Inverness, but my placement as a year three student of ScotGem is in Campbelltown, so that's well over that distance, I should think. So it would be interesting to see some clarity on that.
So would you say, Callum George, then that the limit that Emma Harper has mentioned may not actually apply in practical terms from your experience?
I see Professor Mapstone might have something to say about that, that's beyond the limit for Highland. I don't know whether it's something that specifically applies to the agreement with Dumfries and Galloway Health.
Thank you very much. Sally Mapstone. Yep, certainly. Sally Mapstone.
For information, that I understand that that restriction has partly been in place to protect students' travel time, but that it is actually currently under review. So the fact that Emma Harper raises it is very timely.
Thank you. And Emma Harper.
Thank you, convener, and thanks everybody for that response. I would be keen to find some further detail in that, because I think the ScotGem programme seems to be very positive, and many folks that I know engaging across my region are welcoming it. So thank you.
Thank you very much, and certainly the committee would welcome any update on ScotGem from either or both of the universities that are involved and have been here with us today. Can I say thank you to our witnesses? That's been a very informative session. We will take further evidence next week, when we will hear from the Scottish Government in relation to the bill. But thank you very much, and we will now move on to the next matter under consideration. Thanks very much. The second item on our agenda today is an evidence session on the provisional UK Common Framework on Nutritional Labelling, Composition and Standards. This is the first provisional framework that the Scottish Government has drawn to the Parliament's attention. These frameworks are being developed to ensure that rules and regulations in certain policy areas should be consistent across the UK following our exit from the European Union. Our role as a committee is to scrutinise those common frameworks that fall within our remit. We consider there is a role for the committee to influence the content of the frameworks, to monitor their application, and also to be a conduit between stakeholders and the Scottish Government. We have received now two letters from Joe Fitzpatrick, the Minister for Public Health, Sport and Wellbeing, first of all sharing the provisional UK framework on nutrition labelling, composition and standards, and asking for the committee to provide our commentary on its content. And then just yesterday, we received a further letter answering some of the questions we have put to the Minister. We will be hearing from Joe Fitzpatrick next week, but in the meantime, I welcome to the committee David Thompson, Chief Executive Officer for Food and Drinks Federation Scotland, Pete Ritchie, Executive Director of Nourish Scotland, Professor Paul Haggerty, Deputy Director of the Rout Institute of Nutrition and Health at the University of Aberdeen, one of the six members of the SIPARI Consortium of Scottish Environment, Food and Agricultural Research Institutes, and Martin Keeley, Environmental Health Manager with West Dunbartonshire Council and representing the Society of Chief Officers of Environmental Health in Scotland. Thank you all for joining us today. We have a lot of interest in not only in the framework, but also in your involvement as key parties in the development of the framework. And I wonder if I could start by asking the witnesses, in the order in which I introduced you, what involvement you've had in the development of this or indeed other common frameworks. Have you been invited to comment either by the UK Government, the Scottish Government, or Food Standards Scotland? And if I may start with David Thompson.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the invitation to come and speak at the committee. The Food and Drink Federation is a trade association of food and drink manufacturers, both in Scotland and across the whole of the UK. We have been invited for this common framework. So this common framework is unusual because we've actually had reasonable sight of it over the past year and a half. It was first mooted, first mooted a long time ago, but there was a level of engagement and information about it provided in 2019 around this by both the UK government, Food Standards Agency, Food Standards Scotland. So we did have early sight of it. We have also obviously had sight of it from the 9th of October. And in fact, there has been consultation using this as a basis on nutrition labelling as well. So this, unlike many other of the common frameworks, is one where we have had sight, though obviously as it was finally published on the 9th of October, it's still quite late in the Brexit process, but it's still in advance of many of them.
Thanks very much. Petridge.
Thank you for asking. NERA Scotland hasn't had sight of any of these frameworks before being invited to give evidence by your committee, and that has been frustrating in a sense that they've been invisible, they've been under the radar, and even with the most recent list of frameworks that we were sent. It said that the agricultural support framework, for example, was almost done, and that there had been stakeholder consultation. But as far as I'm aware, we haven't seen that framework, and I'm not sure that Environment Link, that we're a member of, has seen that framework either. So I do think there's been a long period when these things have been invisible to stakeholders, and I think that's unhelpful. The organics framework still hasn't been finalised and is being kicked into 2021. And certainly for a lot of organic businesses, that's unacceptable. They simply don't know where they are with some of the regulatory frameworks there. So I think it's been, you know, I can quite understand all the pressures on the civil servants involved, but in the principle of open government, it would have been helpful, I think, for more stakeholders to be brought in earlier in the conversation.
Thank you very much. Paul Haggerty.
Thank you very much, Convener. I have not been involved in the development of the document and hadn't seen it actually before. It is well prepared and anticipates a lot of the challenges that are going to arise, but possibly not all, and we're keen to have some kind of input into that. I read it in the context of advising the UK in terms of contributing to the Scientific Advisory Committee on Nutrition, Novel Foods, representing the UK in European forums. So having previously contributed to this type of activity before, I'm keen that we are involved in giving a realistic perspective on the true complexity of the food system and the implications of some of the decisions that are made and the anticipation of those. So that's bringing that perspective.
Thanks very much. And Martin Keeley.
Thanks for that. The Society hasn't had significant sight of the framework, but now that it's been provided and having had a discussion with colleagues in Food Standards Scotland, from whom you'll no doubt hear next week, we can see that it touches on the local authority enforcement regime, it touches on divergence in terms of public health needs, it deals with complex issues around definitions, loose definitions of local and approved, and in terms of food circulating in one nation and where it would only be binding on products approved in one nation or imported to that one nation, those are tricky items. We look at the dispute resolution, which has been well worked out, but there is a potential kink in there, which I can touch on, which may have been worked out already, but it's possibly worth raising. And I'm sure that I'll try and answer the questions from the committee from the perspective of the Society of Chief Officers of Environment and Health in Scotland, as it represents the regulator that sits within the local authority framework.
Thanks very much. So in summary, I think the Food and Drink Federation feel well consulted and engaged from an early stage. Other partners have either not been engaged at all, as in I think was Pete Rich's evidence, or only coming to it relatively late in the day. And I think that's interesting. And I guess we're in the context where things are being done against pretty tight timetables. I wonder, can I ask again, any of the witnesses, please indicate with an R in the chat box if you would like to comment. The common framework and the Concordat do not at this stage appear to be finished documents. They don't appear to be in their final form. Does that raise any particular concerns for any of the witnesses? Paul Haggerty.
Some documentation to the committee that they've maybe had a chance to look at, but there were a couple of areas there that are really quite complicated and have important implications. So dietary reference values and reference intakes, they affect food labelling, food safety, the levels at which free vitamins are offered, fortification levels, lots of issues there. And there was some ambiguity about how that would be dealt with. The current arrangement, the implication of the document was that the European Food Safety Authority values would be taken. But that's currently not the way it's done in the UK. There isn't complete harmonisation within the entire EU and EFSA in terms of recommendations. Individual countries make their own recommendations, sometimes using EFSA values. The UK certainly does differ in important ways, and it is important to understand that complexity. And I have a bit of a concern if that wasn't picked up, because that is pretty fundamental. There's another area which is novel foods, and this is really important in terms of innovation within the food system. And it's there to protect the health of the public and consumer rights. And there is a very tight and detailed regulatory process, that evidence process that people have to go through to look at that. And I couldn't see anything on novel foods in the documentation. Maybe there's some, maybe it's in there somewhere. It's not obvious what the link is, but I couldn't see any reference to it. So there are a couple of things that are certainly worth thinking about.
Thank you very much. David Thompson.
Just to correct what I said earlier on, we don't necessarily feel well consulted. We feel better consulted on this than anything else, because we had some introductory material to it last year, but we certainly don't feel as well consulted as we should be on it. In terms of concerns, so I agree with the professor's concerns that he's outlined there. The food industry and the legislation around it is incredibly complex, as I'm sure we're all about to find out over the next few years in terms of its implications for domestic legislation. Our concerns added to that are a little bit more political, I think, in nature. So it is incomplete, and it's incomplete because we don't have the final terms of our trade deal. We don't have a real understanding of the interaction of this legislation with the Northern Ireland Protocol, and we don't have an understanding of how this legislation will be impacted or otherwise by the internal market bill, which is going through Westminster at the moment. So all of these could have a fundamental effect on, in particular, making claims and getting them accredited and dispute resolution.
Thanks very much. Can I ask, again, any of the witnesses who may wish to make a comment? We've heard a little already. Perhaps Pete Ritchie would want to come in on that last question before I go on to Pete Ritchie.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think our main concern is that we've seen this framework now, but we haven't seen, for example, the food composition and labelling framework, which I think I don't know where that is, whether that's available for comment or not. We haven't seen the pesticide common framework and the GM framework has been kicked into touch, and we don't know what the implication of further action on that is. So it just feels as if, to some extent, some things which might fall between the cracks are not being addressed. So it's quite hard to look at one of these common frameworks to do with food without seeing the others and where things might fall within one jurisdiction or another.
And just to be clear, your view, Pietrucci, is that in order to properly scrutinise or comment on this framework, having some more understanding of how the frameworks relate to each other is still a missing sort of essential requirement.
Yes, as everybody said, this is a hugely complex area, and just seeing one bit of the jigsaw, I think, doesn't really give us enough sense of the overall direction. But as David says, you know, the implications of the internal market bill are add another layer of complexity onto this. But certainly we would expect to be able to look at the food compositional standards framework and the pesticide framework and this framework as a whole, because in a sense they all impact on how far policy can diverge in terms of what information consumers are expected to get and how could that diverge across the UK.
Thanks very much. And Martin Keith.
Thanks. Thanks, Chair. I would maybe just touch on, because it is mentioned just in passing about enforcement and divergence, and because it's extremely complex for the enforcement authorities dealing with any kind of divergence where food is imported in one part of the of what's currently the UK. But it may be intended for circulation only in one nation or across all four nations, and so that is a concern. And obviously, people have already touched on the internal markets bill and how that may change the regulatory landscape. I bring it up because the regulator, Environmental Health, particularly in Scotland with its unitary authorities, deals with all aspects of labelling, food, nutrition, etc., and it's extremely challenged at the moment by the impacts of the EU exit and providing for export certification and looking at import controls and you know, we could make reference to unfettered access and how that will impact the landscape. But it's just to raise that there's already a workforce capacity issue. Anything which exacerbates that without bringing a solution to the table is just makes the matter worse. But we do know the attempts in dispute resolution and the attempts to limit divergence and have cooperation across the four nations and consistency. Obviously, those things help the regulator and applying the standards.
Thank you very much. And in addition to the regulatory role of applying the standards in practice, Martin Keeley, what role do you think local authorities should have going forward in the development of this common framework? Are you looking to have an active and hands-on role for local government in this process?
Well, it's maybe worth noting that Environmental Health is the public health profession that sits within the local authority framework, just a benefit of having 32 single-tier local authorities, and Environmental is delivering across those 32 local authorities in Scotland. It's fairly well integrated with Food Standards Scotland. It represents on the Scottish Food Enforcement Liaison Committee. I myself sit on the executive of that committee, and we have excellent dialogue with colleagues in Food Standards Scotland. So it's with those frameworks that exist that we have close working arrangements, and we look for common ways of delivering and ensuring consistency, and that we keep always the public health angle in what we do and what we deliver. Does that answer the question?
I think it does. I guess the question we're looking for as a committee is is to understand how far the implications of this framework are clear to yourselves as regulators and to the other interested parties.
Chair, I would say that there are aspects that are difficult to say just exactly how clear it is to or how it will play out in the future. The thrust, as far as we can see, is to create consistency. And having read all the submissions, there are ambiguities around, you know, things like daily reference values and intakes. There's potential for divergence. I touched on right at the start the idea of food circulating in one nation and any divergent policy affecting food produced in one nation only applying to that food in circulation in that one nation, or food imported. And imports, as I said, are typically happen at very limited points around the UK, and that food is then transferred to some or all of the four nations. So any issue around that inevitably involves the regulator and how and what checks are done at either the point of import, or the point of production, and how the products are mapped in their distribution, and any regulatory decisions would need to come back to the either the point of import or the point of production. So divergence is an issue, although I'm sitting looking right now at the flowchart for resolution on joint decision making, dispute avoidance, and the dispute resolution process. That it's almost an intangible. What might the impact be on the regulator if there were significant changes? Well, it very much depends on whether those changes were across the four nations, and if they were, then everybody can work to the same standard. And if there was divergence, then we would need to look at what that means for an individual nation. I would suggest that it would be very manageable in Scotland with the right resources. But because we're already very integrated as a regulator with intelligence and information that comes from Food Standards Scotland and other sources.
Thank you very much. And again, I think David Thompson wanted to come in on that question. David Thompson.
Thank you. It's just to make the case, as we're talking about regulatory divergence and convergence here, it's really important to state that, obviously, from an industry point of view, the avoidance of any unnecessary technical barriers to trade, so differences in regulation that are unnecessary, is important because, obviously, 70% of all the food that we produce in Scotland goes to the rest of the UK. So we want to make sure that if there are any differences in regulation, they are absolutely justified, because it's critical to the success of food and drink businesses in Scotland that those are minimised. So it's just to make that point. The regulation as it's set out, and the framework as it's set out, suggest ways to deal with that. And from the point of view that, in general, it's a move across of European legislation into the UK as a whole, then that, at the moment, is helpful from an industry perspective.
Very much. Paul Haggerty, to be followed by Petridge. Paul Haggerty.
On the point I think that David was making about the import-export and the complexity of the whole situation, every day, when you are involved in these advisory committees, etc., every day important decisions are being made on food and nutrition across Europe. And if there isn't active attention to that, and the attempt to keep things together, then there will be quite serious divergence. I mean, even in this area of which I mentioned, if a novel food is These things can be used very widely. It would be something like guar gum or modified starch being added to yogurts, etc., to give them bulk and fibre characteristics. So they can be used very widely in products. If that product is authorised in Europe and we haven't caught up with a novel foods an approval in the UK, then that could have quite major implications. So there has to be this constantly looking across between the UK and the EU in terms of where these things are going, if you're not to diverge quite seriously.
Peter Ritchie. Sorry, Mr. Ritchie, we haven't quite got your say yet. No, please start again if you don't mind. Peter Ritchie.
I completely understand David's desire for consistency across the nations and minimising divergence, and also Martin's concern about the ability to enforce these things. But I think we do need to keep coming back to the point of the frameworks, which is to agree a common approach while recognising the capacity for policy divergence. You know, Scotland still has the worst diet in Western Europe, the worst obesity record in Western Europe. We do have an issue, and to the extent that labelling and control of food substances is relevant to that, we have to be able to diverge if that's seen as valuable and helpful, and there's some scientific basis for that. So I just really want to sort of emphasize the fact that the point of these common frameworks is to allow the devolved administrations to diverge and to set their own policies in these areas. And whether that's about preventing, you know, chlorinated chicken being sold in Scotland or GM maize being sold in Scotland, that's within the right of Scottish Parliament to decide. And similarly, if we want to take additional measures to protect the health of our populations by changing the way that certain foods are labelled, then we should be able to do that. And that's a sort of fundamental part of democracy. Mm-hmm. And I just want to say, I noticed reading the papers that apparently we don't need to fortify margarine with vitamins A and D in England, but we do in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. That hasn't led to a sort of total failure of the margarine market. You know, we've managed, and food manufacturers and food retailers cope with significant divergence across Europe and internationally in the way that they market and label foods. So I think we should, you know, always look for consistency wherever possible, wherever sensible, but just keep recognizing the right of the different nations of the UK to diverge.
Thank you very much. I have questions from Emma Harper, first on divergence and then on the Concordat. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. It's just a supplementary about the conversation around divergence. In Scotland, we produce about 70% of the UK's seed potatoes that go abroad. And so if we're using less pesticides in Scotland because our weather's cooler, so our tatties don't get diseases the way others do. So if our seed potatoes have less pesticides, does that then potentially affect our ability to market our crops in a better way, if we have to then look at how this policy divergence, I guess, needs to be tweaked or sorted? Would that affect our Scottish seed producing potato growers?
David Thompson.
Thanks for the question. I think the answer is, you know, as I hope I said, is it's about unnecessary divergence, the unwanted divergence. I think Professor Haggerty has shown the complexity of the issues and you know how it's quite easy to diverge when there's not a conscious thought behind it. And actually, you know, the example that you've given is one where, yes, there's an advantage to our seed potatoes in having that divergence and using the opportunity then and using the, as Pete rightly said, the devolved powers would be appropriate. It's really what I'm trying to get at is this gives us a way to manage things in a way that is coherent and any divergence is conscious.
Martin Keeley.
Thanks, Chair. I think those are very good points that have been raised. Divergence is necessary, and that's provided for in the framework. It's recognised that, that divergence for public health reasons may be necessary, and it's pointed out that obviously if you live in a place with where people are exposed to less sunlight, then they may get less vitamin D, and you may need a supplement in the diet. And tackling and certainly some of Scotland's significant challenges around diet and obesity and the effect that it has on health all need to be weighed in. There was a question about who would who keeps an eye on the lists and following risk assessment and introduction in the EU. That is a question that needs bottomed out, and Food Standards Scotland colleagues will no doubt have something to say about that. Who holds the list? Who does the review? What is the mechanism for bringing it inside the regulatory framework of the UK? And how does that impact on the regulatory landscape? That's it.
Thank you. Peter Ritchie.
Helpful question, Emma. Quite a challenging question, but probably within another framework. But I think that general principle that we should be able to make the most of differences in the way that we label and market food from Scotland, I think, is really important. One of the things that's going to come soon, certainly Denmark is looking at the moment about greenhouse gas labelling on all food products. That's something which is going to be brought in probably in different countries in different ways. And again, there's a really big question about, do we wait for an EU-wide labelling scheme on those things? Or do we go ahead with a UK-wide scheme, or do different countries want to move further and faster on this? And I think certainly that as the sort of connections between food and climate change increase, I think that question about environmental labelling is going to become quite a hot potato.
Thank you very much. Emma Harper.
Thanks, everybody. I will move on now, and I'll the Concordat states that parties shall inform one another of meetings with industry within their territories, which potentially affect the policy areas covered by this Concordat or the framework. Is this something that you're aware of, and would this raise any particular issues? I know that earlier, Pete Ritchie, you said that you hadn't had sight of any of the frameworks, and I'm just wondering how exclusive it is for Food Standards Scotland to only have sight of the frameworks, or whether Food and Drink Administration needs to also feed into it, because everybody has expert knowledge in order to pick apart what is required in the frameworks.
Pete Ritchie.
I suppose the part of the whole context of this is, we hugely welcome Parliament's scrutiny of these frameworks. I think that's a really important part of the policymaking process, and probably quite a precedent that's being set in a sense in terms of Parliament having a look at these quite detailed intergovernmental decision-making processes. Most of them are, very technical, a lot obviously about dispute resolution, but it does feel important to me that, this is a big moment leaving the EU and looking at how we're going to do things going forwards, and that involving a whole variety of stakeholders and having that conversation seems to me a very important step forward, and that it shouldn't be simply seen as a technical matter for industry, because it is a matter of values as well as a matter of the technicalities of food marketing and labelling.
David Thompson.
Just to add, on the question of, should different governments talk to each other when they've had meetings with industry, I think that's perfectly reasonable. It's one of the key areas where the administrations develop trust between themselves and are more likely to come to a common ground on the specifics of these issues. So I don't see any particular issue in particular, as most of the areas here are really, as Pete said, within the very, very technical areas of composition and standards. That doesn't mean that there won't be difference between them, but I think there shouldn't be anything to be concerned about by the governments sharing information.
Martin Keeley.
Thanks, Chair, and I'll try not to sound as if I'm repeating myself, but the Scottish Food Enforcement Liaison Committee, for which Food Standards Scotland provide the secretariat and all local authority environmental health is involved with, and industry is on that committee by invite. It's an excellent forum for the sharing of information, and whilst Food Standards Scotland keep a detailed eye on the frameworks and the technical detail, it does bring the issues and the detail to the committee for input. So that's an important aspect of information sharing, and it's already been touched on that governments sharing across the four nations for data, scientific information and intelligence is generally regarded as a good thing, and there is a framework for that as well.
Thank you very much. And one more question from Emma Harper before we go to Sandra White. Emma Harper.
Thanks. It's just a final question. It seems that this is going to need to be ongoing work, that this is a massive amount of work that everybody is now involved in when we've already got EU existing legislation, and we're about to exit or the transition's about to be complete in 30 days. So it seems that all of this big jigsaw that Pete Ritchie talks about will need to continue. Do you see it continuing like long into the next parliamentary session? Are we going to need much more time to scrutinise all these frameworks as we're heading into the next parliamentary session?
Thanks. Paul
Haggerty. Thank you, convener. I think what's coming across here and comes across partially in the document is the complexity of the system. And it involves multiple advisory groups, multiple systems, and the current framework is a great aspiration, but underneath it all, there is immense potential for things to go wrong, unforeseen consequences. And personally, I would recommend not kicking off from any current working arrangement until we absolutely understand how the arrangement operates and we can put something else in place. So you can do it partially, you can do it incrementally. But the first thing to do is to understand how the system currently operates and how it interconnects with everything else. And then if you think you can deal with that, then push off from that by all means. But I think it's the understanding is important.
Thank you. David Thompson.
So the answer to the question is yes, it's an ongoing piece of work, and as Professor Haggerty said, it's a complex piece of work. So we would fully expect this to continue working for a long period of time, and for its need to be scrutinised significantly along the way, in particular where things don't happen in the way that they're expected. So this and all the other frameworks are going to be a long term piece of work.
Peter.
Briefly, I completely agree with that. I think it is vital that Parliament does maintain scrutiny of this. As Professor Haggerty said, it is complicated, but then that's why it's important that Parliament has oversight of it and is poking into, well, what does this actually mean for people and for Scotland? Absolutely.
Thank you. And I now call Sandra White.
And good morning, gentlemen. As has been said before, it is an ongoing piece of work, and it is very important that we do absolutely scrutinise this legislation, even though it's very complicated in that respect. And I think we need to remind ourselves that we're only, 30 days to Brexit Day, and we still don't really know what's going on. My questions are primarily to do with how different countries are going to work together under this framework, particularly when we're looking at the Northern Ireland Protocol and obviously the UK Internal Market Bill and how that fits into it. So my first question would be that to yourselves, do you have any concerns as to how the different countries will work and operate in conjunction with each other in this particular framework? and what effect the Ireland Northern Ireland Protocol may have on the working in conjunction.
David Thompson, trade was between Scotland and Northern.
Yeah, as I said at the start, the short answer is we don't know. The slightly longer answer is, we already know that the Northern Ireland Protocol seems to dictate that there will be joint labelling and a joint approach between European and UK legislation there. We have just had a UK survey, so forgive me, but 40% of the people who responded to our survey suggested that they were not going to supply into Northern Ireland for the first few months of next year because they don't know how it's going to work. So there's a specific issue there with Northern Ireland and how it all works. In terms of the Internal Market Bill, there's no reference, I think, still to the common frameworks in the Internal Market Bill as it's currently constructed. So we've got no idea how the principles that are in the Internal Market Bill interact with the decision frameworks and dispute avoidance frameworks that are set out in this regulation. So there are lots of unanswered questions. Do we need those questions answered by the 30th or 31st of December? Not really. We need them answered, as Professor Haggerty has said, when these issues really come to the fore. But we don't know when that will be, because it will be when something comes to test them. So we have huge concerns about how all this works and how the different pieces of legislation and international agreements interact with each other.
Thank you.
Thank
you. I just wonder if any other witnesses wanted to comment on that particular part of it. Okay.
Thanks very much, Sandra. Petridge. I'll come back to you, Sandra. Yeah, Pete Richard, please.
Thank you.
Absolutely. I think what the Common Frameworks documents show is, I suppose, is just how complicated this is and how many processes you need to work together on these things effectively over time. And what we've seen, obviously, is the civil servants in the four nations actually worked together very constructively on this process over the last 3 years, putting in a lot of time, a lot of hours, to work out these common frameworks and the dispute resolution procedures. And the Internal Market Bill, goes against the whole spirit of the common frameworks, which say, no surprises, don't drop surprises on each other. It just takes a wrecking ball to that very careful sort of joint work, joint respectful work between the four nations on reaching agreement wherever possible and valuing divergence wherever necessary. So the crudity of the Internal Market Bill in terms of its procedures for dealing with divergence, is just in stark comparison to the sort of sophistication of these frameworks. And I think, we need to see the bill amended to have primacy of common frameworks, because they're the way that the governments of the four nations are going to work together going forward. The Internal Market Bill mechanisms won't work.
Thank you very much. Paul Hackett.
Thank you, convener. Reading through the document, it looked like there was very little scope actually for divergence within the UK, or not much attention given to it. And in reality, it would be quite a difficult thing to do. Pete gave some examples of things that could be done set differently, vitamin D and some other things. Certainly possible at the edges. I think Emma Harper, I think it was, the example of pesticides and seed potatoes. that's a good example, because it probably you could, it would be a soft claim that you could make in relation to that. Governments are interested in regulation and jumping regulatory hurdles, whereas consumers and individuals within a country would be more interested in these kind of soft claims that might change the uptake of something. But the regulatory framework, as in this document, I think makes it quite difficult for real divergence.
Okay. Sandra Hart.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I think all of the witnesses touched on the internal market and obviously the Northern Ireland Protocol. But I was interested in the reply back from the Food and Drinks Association. You mentioned a survey and that people would not be sending products to Northern Ireland in the first 3 months. I just wonder what the either Food and Drinks Federation or other witnesses thought about that and the knock-on effect to the economy in Scotland as well. Would that have a knock-on effect? We were talking about seed potatoes earlier on, if you were sending them, say, to Northern Ireland or whatever. What types of food and drink would we not be exporting to Northern Ireland in those couple of months, which has already been mentioned?
Martin Keith.
Okay, thanks for that. I'd maybe just say that I'm heavily involved in the preparation for Brexit in terms of export, and the Northern Ireland Protocol deeply affects that. And it may be that setting aside, our nutrition and labelling aspects, that people may opt not to to send products in Northern Ireland. Where they are products of animal origin or high-risk products that not of animal origin that may need certification. And the certification process is very detailed. And because moving food across to Northern Ireland, it needs to be able to then go to the EU. And that is a process that involves cost and administration, so direct cost and indirect cost. And businesses may choose not to do that. And we are, for quite some time, we've been working pretty much flat out trying to develop a system which creates the least amount of barrier to trade for the Scottish products that go to the EU. And now that means Scottish products that go to Northern Ireland. And that's aside from the import unfettered access commitments and what that means to products that come across from Ireland and Northern Ireland, quite often through Northern Ireland to Scotland, that then end up in domestic products. And we do import quite a lot of goods, foods from Ireland and from Northern Ireland, which we then incorporate into products that are sold in Scotland. There's a huge body of work, and I touched on right at the start the impact on the regulator, on environmental health and capacity, because we don't have enough people coming through just to meet the existing needs and the additional burdens of Brexit have placed an enormous demand on environmental health in Scotland and no doubt in the other nations as well. So it may be that people are doing it for another reason, and those reasons are entirely legitimate and completely understandable, given the cost and the time involved in getting across those export humps, if you like.
David Thompson.
Martin has given a fantastic answer there, but if you consider those additional costs and you consider the additional complexities of, potentially needing to have a European address, which you would need to have if you exported to Northern Ireland, that means that there are significant additional costs. And some businesses are taking the commercial decision, as well as, in some areas where there are legislative barriers being put in place, that commercial decision is it's the Northern Ireland market. It's either not worth it for me to have a different pack, or it's not worth it for me because I don't know if my product will be legal at this stage. And that's why they're taking those decisions at this time. And that may change as the situation clarifies in Northern Ireland. But at the moment, 40% of our members who responded to clear that they were not intending to move goods to Northern Ireland over the first few months.
Thank you very much. And call Donald Camp.
Yeah. Hello, good morning to everyone. I'd like to carry on the discussion about parliamentary scrutiny, and I appreciate that several of you have touched on this already. But I just wonder if you would reflect on what further role it would be helpful to both the wider industry and consumers for the Scottish Parliament to perform in relation to the framework.
Pete Ritchie.
That's a big question, a very good question, Dom, thank you. For me, the Parliament's key role here, as I was trying to say earlier, is to pull out of the technical complexity, if you like, what the implications are for policymaking in Scotland, if any. And for some of these frameworks, there'll be almost none, because the effect of the frameworks will be status quo. There'll be some frameworks that are relatively uncontroversial. And we've got to, we've had joint arrangements, you know, as you know, Dom, between, you know, UK and Scottish administrations over, you know, cross-border animal movements, animal health, veterinary services, plant safety. All of these things have been operating with different competencies between England and Scotland, but operating absolutely fine for many years. So a lot of these frameworks will be uncontroversial. The key thing, I think, is where there are policy implications, and where what we want to do in Scotland, whether that's with our agriculture or with our fisheries or with our food labelling, our consumer messaging, you know, those things, where those things are, there's a value in those diverging for good reasons, then I think Parliament's got a really important role in trying to tease out how these common frameworks can be used to everybody's advantage. I mean, the point of the common frameworks, and we have to keep coming back to this, is to provide consistency where possible and divergence where necessary. And that's, you know, that's something I think Parliament has a really useful job in, both understanding what the implications are and communicating those implications to the wider public, because they otherwise will remain very much within government and within technical committees that most members of the public don't even know exist.
David Thompson, followed by Martin Keeley. David Thompson.
So I think there's two key areas. You know, one of them is set out in the framework and the decision-making framework itself, which is around making the regulations that flow from this. So for me, in the making the regulations that flow from this, which might be at UK or at devolved Parliament level, I think there's obviously a clear role for the Parliament in those. And when doing that, then I guess our ask would be for the parliamentarians to, you know, consider the need for divergence very strictly indeed, and to make sure that there is a clear case for when that is in place. I think the second area is around how this all works in terms of the actual disputes. So there's looking at the dispute resolution process, there's not necessarily a role for Parliament as set out there. And when you read that across to the internal market bill, you do have a dispute resolution mechanism for disagreements there, but it's done only at UK level. And we've been very clear throughout all the consultations on the internal market bill, and we want to be clear in the common frameworks, that any dispute resolution has to have a reference to the four parliaments, because that's the only way that it will have credibility in the four parliaments.
Good. Martin Keeley.
Thanks. Thanks again for indulging me. It's just to make a general point on whether on the resourcing the regulator, because the official control, delivery of official controls that relate to food are delivered by Environmental Health in Scotland, and Environmental Health is under-resourced and doesn't have a sustainable stream of professionals coming through. So whether you have divergence or whether you have convergence, whether you are regulating for the domestic market or whether you're regulating for producers and manufacturers who are putting to Europe or indeed in third countries, and you need a sustainable and reliable regulatory resource in order to deliver those those national controls, because those are the controls that underpin the reputation of the food industry, and Scotland's food industry has an immense reputation domestically and worldwide. So that would be my general point on resourcing the regulator. And I do, just to touch on what was said a moment ago, I would echo that that the framework in terms of dispute resolution, just to step aside, does involve the four nations, but as touched upon the internal market bill, does not appear to be the case, and that would be a serious concern. But my main point is, if you want to have your reputation as a food nation domestically and for export, you need a sustainable regulator, and that's not currently provided for, and we'd like to see that change.
Thank you for all those answers, and I particularly note what was said about regulation and dispute resolution. I just wonder if there are any other specific events which should trigger a parliamentary engagement with the operation of the framework. So, for instance, I think the House of Lords Committee on Common Frameworks has suggested that there's an annual report on the activities of the NLCS policy group, and that might be one such event that would trigger scrutiny. Are there any other events that our witnesses can think of that would trigger scrutiny?
Any thoughts on that from any witnesses, or indeed on the policy group and that as a trigger, Martin Keith?
I could see a situation that may trigger the framework, where there's a referral back from Europe for the food that we either put to Northern Ireland or direct to Europe, that complies with domestic legislation but is being challenged by the EU, and which would then cause us to look at our list and our whether there's reference values or some other aspect of a food, an ingredient, and whether that's manufactured in one nation or all four nations, could possibly trigger the use of the framework and a review of that product or that ingredient or a novel food.
And that, in your view, would be something Parliament should take an interest in?
I would think that it would be, given that it would be a national concern, it would be something that Parliament may want to take an interest in.
Thank you very much. Can I now call, if Don Cameron is done, I'll call Brian Whittle. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Gavina. Again, good morning to the panel. I wanted to look at the issues that are going to be covered within the framework. And we know nutritional claims, health claims, additional vitamins and food-specific groups of food supplements, etc. But I think for me, the crux of this is around how the framework may impact on the health of individuals in Scotland. I think it's already been mentioned. We don't have a good health report card when it comes to health in Scotland. So I wonder what the panel think, whether the arrangements would set out in the framework actually present issues or opportunities to deliver on the health of individuals in Scotland.
Pete Ritchie.
I think the frameworks are an enabling mechanism, Brian. You know, they allow policy proposals to come forward from Scottish ministers, from Scottish civil servants, to be discussed and debated in across the four nations. And my expectation is that, you know, the hope always would be, because we're not that dissimilar in terms of our health profiles, that measures which are good for the people of Scotland in terms of changing labelling or composition of food are also good for the people of the rest of the UK, and that those measures could be seen as relevant across the whole of the UK. But as we've seen in recent years, sometimes Wales has gone first, sometimes Scotland has gone first, sometimes England has gone first, and I think sometimes Northern Ireland has gone first in some of these measures. So that, you know, it's a really helpful process to have individual nations try something out, move forward on it, with all due respect to, you know, the needs of manufacturers and retailers and all that. But I think it's very, very helpful to have that policy marketplace where people can try things out. So I suppose I think the common frameworks, if they're allowed to carry on in the form with the dispute resolution mechanisms and the consensus building mechanisms that are in place, then I think they can provide a valuable way for Scotland to bring things forward, to try things out with consent and to monitor those things and hopefully to get the best ones adopted across the UK.
David Thompson?
I think the important thing for us from an industry perspective is to ensure that the evidence base for any changes brought under this is clear and understood. We already have in Europe a very, very strict set of rules for nutrition and health claims made on foods. There is opportunity there, I'm sure. But on the other hand, we need to make sure, in order to protect people, that the science and evidence behind any health claims or health opportunities is fully understood and recognised, because we need to make sure that we're protecting people. So from our perspective, any changes would need to have that science and evidence base behind it in order for it to be, to pass the very high standards that we want for food and drink in the UK.
Right, Whittle.
Thank you. I think Mr. Thompson's kind of led me into my final question here was basically looking at the particular issues that may or may not be around for the food and drink sector in Scotland as a result of the proposed arrangements.
David Thompson, followed by Paul Haggerty. David Thompson.
Well, I think there are opportunities. So it may be that as things move forward and we begin to diverge more from European legislation, that there are opportunities in a different type of health claim than is currently allowed in Europe. So one that is still science and evidence-based, but is perhaps has a different way of looking at the health claims. And there's potential opportunities in all the different areas, composition and labelling and nutrition declarations. So there are potential opportunities in there for businesses to take advantage of a different way of looking at these things, but still being led by the science. I'm not making the case that we need to be laxer. What I'm making the case is that with the bodies looking at it from a UK perspective, there may well be opportunities for Scottish businesses to develop and flourish in different ways than are currently allowed under the European legislation.
Paul Haggerty.
Thank you, convener. If I could go back to the earlier question that was raised, I think there is an opportunity here with this document for Scottish Parliament government to focus on nutrition and health more generally. And I think this is a really important issue and can be done. In terms of what the Scotland can do differently, it's important to realise that the science is not going to be different across the UK. The DRVs are the same. They will not differ. So your vitamin D requirement is the same. Whereas the implementation of that might differ. To come on to your second point about the thinking about the health claims, or I guess David's point, which is that there is now a committee being set up in the UK to look at health claims, and I know that they are taking almost exactly the European route, because that is the evidence, that's the gold standard in terms of evidence base. And I would worry slightly about David's point about diverging on that. I really don't think there's a lot of flexibility in terms of moving away from the scientific evaluation that's set out there. But I would reassure that the UK will have a good system in place for health claims.
Thank you very much. And I call, we have Martin Keeley, I think, comment on that question as well. Martin.
I think it's important to have a very tightly regulated system against health claims. But there is the issue of what's not on food that may influence consumer choice. and particularly in relation to health, diet and obesity. And having done some work on price promotions and you know, looking at how we nudge population behaviour in a healthier direction, there is something to be said for having different displays, information of food, things that are not currently there, as well as looking at what the regulated health claims are, so things that are on it, things that are not currently on it, and how that affects our population health, and whether that, and whether where those items are necessary and need to be different for the different populations in the four nations. And again, just to touch on Scotland's significant health challenges that are related to diet and alcohol as well. So the messaging is important, and it may be that the divergence is necessary in order to adjust the population health and get a national benefit.
Thank you very much. And now Colin David Stewart.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to witnesses. My questions are for Professor Haggerty. You described the text on dietary reference values as ambiguous. Can you expand that point?
Paul Haggerty.
Yes. I guess the what it seemed to imply was that there was a system in place created by EFSA that we could take. So there would be a list of nutrients and there would be a reference value associated with each. So that was the way I read the documentation. But that's not currently the way the thing works in the UK or, in fact, in any other EU country. There is not complete harmonisation between the countries and EFSA. So each country has, like, we have a different recommendation in relation to N6 polyunsaturated fatty acids from EFSA does. And we currently use that in terms of our recommendations that we make in the UK. So we have to have clarity on what we're using and how that might change going forward.
David Stewart.
Okay, thank you for that answer. And my final question is, how important is access to scientific expertise in making measured assessments about the categories of food and additives contained in the framework?
Paul Haggerty.
This is absolutely vital. And one of the things that FSS might think about doing in future is consulting with the current advisory committees. So you've got Advisory Committee on Nutrition, Advisory Committee on Toxicity, Novel Foods, Microbiology. It would be useful to send this framework to those committees and ask for their comments. But it is absolutely critical that whatever these committees are all plugged into the current process, and there is a requirement to consult with them. And I think that's what I was saying earlier on about it's important to understand the full complexity of the system so that it can at least be replicated, or the UK or the nations can make a decision on what they don't want to replicate. The important thing is not to lose sight of the reality of the situation.
Okay. Thank you.
Pete Ritchie. Pete Ritchie.
Absolutely vital to have a very strong science base on this. But we also want to point out that the science does change, and the orthodoxies change over time. You know, we used to be quite focused on cholesterol. It was a huge thing that we all spent a lot of time worrying about. We spend less time worrying about it now. And over the last few years, the whole interest in the microbiome has exploded. I mean, we didn't talk about it 10 years ago. We talk about it a lot now. And the impact of different foods on that microbiome is a subject of, you know, lots of research and lots of discussion, lots of conversation. And it may well be that over time, we will be looking at labeling foods in terms of, you know, their impact on the microbiome. The degree of processing is a big issue in Brazil, not so much here. So all I'm saying is that these things will change over time, and we're always open in our science to looking at new evidence coming in as well, and not always relying on what we used to think was best for our health.
Good. I call David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to all panel members. Are you reassured that the role of scientific evaluation is adequately catered for in the proposed process for assessing nutrition and health claims and for a request related to other categories of vitamins, minerals, food supplements and foods for specific groups?
Paul Harrington.
Thank you, David. I guess this comes back to the points that we've already been discussing. I think this is quite a short document to cover a very complicated system, and it's not surprising that it's quite high level. So there may be information underneath this that that would give reassurance in terms of the quality of the advice taken, but it's not there yet. It's not made explicit. And I think when you're talking about regulation, it's very important to make it explicit about which committees are involved, what kind of advice they're being asked for. And I think a piece of work needs to be done on that to.
Thank you. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. My last question, the proposed process for assessing additives and food groups align or not with that in place under EU membership and the associated transition period?
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask David Thompson in relation to alignment, and then I'll come to Martin Keeley after that.
You could ask me, but I'm afraid I wouldn't know 100%, so probably best to go on to Martin.
Right, no, sorry, Martin wasn't asking to be called. Maybe I'll come back to Paul Haggerty again. In a sense, it's a follow-on from the previous question, isn't it? Paul Haggerty.
Yeah, so Convener, just remind me what what that point was.
David Torrance was asking whether the proposed processes for assessing additives and food groups aligned or not with what's in place already under EU membership and transition.
Yeah, I think the way it's set out in the document, it kind of implies that the current EFSA agreements and arrangements will be superimposed in the future arrangement. But with the dietary reference values and some other things, I tried to point out that there was maybe that hadn't been completely bottomed out. So I just wonder if the document kind of postpones the decision on that a little bit. I think it's important, as with David's last point, to be much clearer in terms of what's going to happen with this area.
Thank you very much. I've now got questions from George Adam, who will be followed by Emma Harper. George Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. This has all been very interesting this morning. One of the proposals is for the policy group, the NLCS policy group. Now, that's obviously, we've talked about this quite a bit today with regards to coming, finding common recommendations for ministers for decisions in all four nations and the most suitable approach. My question would be, does the formation of an NLCS policy group seem like a sensible mechanism, and the current proposals, will it deliver?
I wonder, Pete Ritchie, would you like to kick off on the NLCS policy group?
I'll try. I mean, my understanding is that it's a very sensible step forward. You know, that having that opportunity for people, across the four nations to talk about these policies seems entirely sensible to me, because it provides the foundation of trust and working together and sharing information on which you can then decide, do we need to diverge or can we have a consistent approach? So it seems to be a very sensible starting point. Absolutely.
David Thompson.
I agree with Pete. He's right in terms of the need for dialogue across the four nations. In fact, I would base I'm surprised if this dialogue isn't happening already anyway, and we know it has been. So this is just a formalisation of that. I suppose with a formalisation comes two concerns, one at either end. So as Professor Haggerty has set out, what evidence and what advice is this policy group getting in order to form policy and develop new proposals? And then secondly, at the other end is, you know, once they have agreed to agree or agreed to disagree, how does that fall into the political decision-making arena and dispute resolution and parliamentary scrutiny? So it's a useful middle part and hopefully the glue that holds all this together.
On the back of that, David, do you have any views on the skills and expertise that any designated lead official should have in being part of that group?
Yeah, I mean, I think they need to obviously, you know, as a designated lead official for a particular area, they need to have the scientific and technical understanding. So we would expect it to be a technical professional within the organisations, with the support, I think, of a senior official if there is if there are issues in terms of disputes or differences. But, you know, firstly and most importantly, I think, is their ability to understand the advice that they're getting and then to translate that into policy action.
Yes, thank you, Convener. One final question, and anyone can answer this one, is do you believe that we'll have the type of expertise needed to be available to the policy group?
Paul Haggerty.
I think the answer is yes. The UK punches above its weight in terms of providing this kind of expertise in Europe, and its its advisory bodies are very highly regarded within Europe, and I see no reason why it could not create the appropriate structures.
Thank you very much. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I found it quite interesting so far this morning, and it seems indeed very complex, and we're going to be looking at other frameworks as well. One is the Food Compositional Standards and Labelling Framework. And so I'm interested in whether, like, are we ready? We're 30 days until January the 1st, and do we know how products will be labelled, like organic produce, produce in Scotland? How is it going to be labelled if it's being shipped? It seems to me that we're not ready, and I know that we have issues with inspectors in Northern Ireland at Larne and Belfast, and then obviously local authority environmental health personnel that are required as well. I mean, so the bottom line is, are we ready for January the 1st?
Martin Keith.
I do enjoy a leading question. The resource hasn't been there for some time. In terms of national delivery of an environmental health resource, there hasn't been a national system provided for, and there hasn't been investment in the local authority provision of those professionals. And that is something that needs to be addressed, and that is something myself as chair of the Workforce Strategy Group on behalf of the Society, and engaging with COSLA and Scottish Government in order to try and provide in a strategic way the resource that's necessary for the public health delivery system in Scotland through environmental health that sits within the local authority. That's a given, and as a nation we need to work to provide that national resource. But your question was about, are we ready in day one? And that's whilst a simple question, it's very complex in all its component parts. Theoretically, nothing should change on day one in terms of labelling and content, because businesses have been working to European standards right up until this point. So theoretically, it shouldn't change. But you've got this issue of export, where the UK is a third country, or it becomes a third country, sits outside of the EU, and it, therefore, any food that it would have previously circulated in the common market is regarded as coming from a third country and needs export certification, and businesses may choose not to for financial reasons and other reasons. But we, as the public health regulator and provider for export certification for fish and fishery products, have created a system which is, as far as we can tell, has been accepted to allow those products to be exported certificated to either go through Northern Ireland or to go direct to Europe. And that's as much as we can reasonably do. But we are stretched. So is business, does it affect business? Maybe if it doesn't affect them if on day one in terms of their labelling, because it's currently compliant with EU regs. Will it comply in the future? We don't know, because there may be changes. Is the regulatory system inside the nation set up to deliver for the future? No, it's under financed, and it's not provided for in a strategic way in order to meet the national need, and that needs addressed. I'm not sure whether I covered all aspects of your question. I'm happy to take a further question.
Thanks very much. I'll perhaps come to David Thompson and Peter Ritchie, and then come back to Emma for any follow-up on Martin's evidence. David Thompson.
So I guess a couple of things. On the, as I said earlier, on this particular piece of work and the framework, the frameworks in general, internal market bill and how all that works, then obviously these won't be in place by the 1st of January. How critical that is, as Martin says, I'm not entirely sure, because essentially the regulation remains the same, but it's when we get to the point of divergence and maybe some of those day-to-day decision-making issues that others have talked about, that may be an issue there. I would agree with Martin, we need to absolutely ensure that Food Standards Scotland and our environmental health system is properly regulated to make sure we maintain high standards, avoid fraud, etc. So there's a huge amount of work there, and in fact a lot of work in terms of educating the food industry about how to be healthier, more effective and safer. It's really important that they're in place. In terms of Brexit, just a couple of things. We have, the FDF have 171 questions that we gave to the UK government in July this year. So far we have 87 of them answered, 75 of them requiring further information and 9 unanswered. So it's not a surprise that businesses don't appear to be ready, because they don't have the full information that requires them. So the survey that I talked about that we've just done, again, UK level, just got it last night, shows that around 42% of businesses just don't think they will be ready for Brexit.
Thank you. Pete Ritchie to be followed by Paul Haggard.
So there, just specifically on the organic sector, the fact the organics common framework isn't going to be even considered till next year. And certainly I know that there are real glitches in terms of importing organic products from third countries outside the EU at the moment. How far those will affect manufacturers of organic products here, and how far the EU and UK authorities will, you know, cooperate to not look too closely at what's going on, I'm not sure. But certainly for some businesses, you know, it is they're certainly not ready, and they don't know how they're going to be able to do certain things on January the 1st.
Paul Haggard.
Thank you. The having listened to this discussion, I'm very reassured by the contributions of Martin in particular, in terms of what has been prepared. But certainly I would encourage a conservative approach on this. Try and stick with what we've got until we're sure we can change. But even doing that, there are going to be challenges. On day one, the situation can change from under you. If the EU authorises a novel ingredient or process, for example, not looking at just now some other processes, then we have to respond to that immediately, or we have diverged. And we've immediately got issues there. So so be conservative at the start, but you can't be relaxed about the timetable.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I think one of my concerns is that our organic producers in Scotland might feel a bit, pressured if we're not even going to have a common framework for them until next year. So I'm sure that might affect their perceptions of how their business would need to be taken forward. But and the novel foods issue is interesting as well, because if we are looking at cholesterol reducing spreads, for instance, I'm just looking at new foods with phytosterols and phytostanols used in cholesterol reducing spreads. So all of these might be produced, but then we would need to be considering how those are then brought in or moved around the country, and then obviously there might be divergence issues. So I'm envisaging there's going to be challenges. So do you see that there will be this constant effort to try and address the challenges that present, whether it's products coming from Europe or UK trying to get products out to Europe?
If I could ask witnesses to hold that question, and I will add another one, and then ask you to respond to both Emma's question and mine. My question is simply around the dispute resolution mechanisms and the joint decision-making mechanisms. If there are any thoughts that witnesses have on those and ways in which those might be improved, as well as Emma's question around putting novel foods and so on. Start with Martin McKee.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose, first of all, to commend the individuals who've put this together, and I'm specifically looking at Appendix 4 in the Joint Decision-Making Dispute Avoidance Dispute Resolution Process. My concern would be when you run through all of the logic gate sequences and you get to gate 1.6 and then you get to no decision, decision put on hold for further evidence to be submitted. My concern would be whether that would be used in one member, one nation, as a veto on something being done, that it would not then move to a decision where it was either accepted or rejected on a UK-wide basis, or with agreed divergence. That would be a holding box, that no decision would be a holding box, in effect, a veto mechanism. And I'm sure thought has gone into that. So I'm reading it just as a first take, and but that would be a concern.
David Thompson.
On the question of decision making, I think that's where we remain unclear as to how decisions will actually be decided. So, you know, if there is decision making and its interaction with the internal market bill here, then you know, it quite quickly gets to the point where evidence is. As soon as you involve ministers, then evidence is one part of the story, and political considerations are another part of the story. So I guess it's that box. The box is 1.4 and 1.6, which is just what is the reality of that going to be? Is our biggest concern. And on Emma's point around is this going to be constantly tested? Yes, it's going to be constantly tested. It's going to be constantly tested in two ways. The first is the ongoing march of European legislation. In this and in compositional standards and everything, there's a constant programme of additional risk management and other approaches by Europe. Every time Europe makes a decision, we in the UK will have to consider that decision and then make it or not make it for ourselves. It seems to me, reading from it, that there's a potential delay in that of within 4 years for some substances in one of the annexes. So it's going to be tested from day one because, you know, Europe are making legislation that will impact next year and so on. So every time that happens, then this framework will be tested.
Thank you very much. And if there's no further comments on those final questions from witnesses, can I thank all of our witnesses this morning. It's been an extremely informative session and covered a wide range of aspects of the Common Framework, and certainly as our first opportunity as a committee to consider a Common Framework, it has been extremely helpful indeed. We will hear, as I say, from the Government next week. We will now move into private session and we will reconvene on a different platform at 12:20. But thank you very much to those witnesses and our earlier witnesses, and I now suspend this meeting.